Hi, this video was made by Salman Hosseini and narrated by Nilufar Skandari from Hyperlyceum team. In this video, we're going to define non-uniform load in two different ways. In the first method, we use Dload subroutine, and in the next one, we'll use analytical field tool in Abaqus CAE. Also, we'll learn how to write Dload subroutine, and some more information about analytical field tool will be discussed in this video. At first, I'm going to explain analytical field and Dload subroutines. Then we'll go through using these two methods in a model. In the following, we'll solve non-uniform load once with the analytical field and once with Dload subroutine. At the end, we'll evaluate the results together. Analytical field tool, which is defined in Abaqus CAE, is used for non-uniform loading as a function of location. The toolbar shown above is for the purpose of listing the formulas and functions required for loading. The box you see in the left section is the name of the parameters that can be used in the loading formula, which depends on the coordinate system. The Cartesian coordinate system is defined here by default, and we can also use cylindrical and spherical coordinate systems. In the side box, there are the parameters and operators that we can use to define our load. Finally, you will see how the loading created using the formula in the toolbar, and we'll explain this loading in more detail. Now, once we have solved it with analytical field, then use Dload subroutine. In Abaqus CAE, location-dependent loads can be defined using the analytical field, which you saw in the previous slide. Loads that are a function of time can then be defined using amplitude. In this section, you can see that we can use Abaqus CAE for loads that are both location and time dependent. However, when our simulation is complicated, such as moving load, we need to use Dload subroutine. As an example, consider a tube that receives heat overnight and changes loading conditions, all of which require writing subroutine. One of the advantages of subroutine writing is that the subroutine gives us lots of flexibility. Another advantage is that we can call a number of outputs for a subroutine to make it solution dependent, which is not available in Abaqus CAE. In fact, subroutine provides capabilities that are not available in other software or are difficult to use. Here we examine the model that has been created. It is 2 meters long, 0.1 meters wide, and 0.02 meters thick. The image on the right shows the loading, which is created twice, once using the analytical field and once with the Dload subroutine. As you can see at the beginning of the work, the load is in a downward direction. Then the load is negative and the direction of the arrows changes upwards, and the diagram becomes sinusoidal. Here we see the function by which we have determined the non-uniform loading pattern. F equals the Q times sine pi z. As you know, the sines function in a trigonometric circle reach their maximum in pi divided by 2 and 3 pi divided by 2. So at pi divided by 2, it has a value of 1, which is the maximum of the sines. And at 3 pi divided by 2, it reaches a negative value of 1 and changes its direction. The image on the right side, the highest point of the semicircle of length z is half, which if placed in the formula we mentioned earlier, is equal to pi divided by 2. The lower part of the semicircle in the image is equal to 3 divided by 2, which is equal to 3 pi divided by 2 in the formula. In this case, its value is maximum and in the negative direction. Here the direction of loading is reversed. The simulation results are displayed in the slide. The simulation was performed once with the analytical field as shown on top, and the one with Dload subroutine shown at the bottom of the image. Now we move to the software to create and simulate both models in Abaqus software. Open the software. At the beginning, create a panel and set the approximate size to 1, and then click on continue. From the center, draw a rectangle with a width of 0.1 and the thickness of 0.02. To do this, first draw a rectangle with an approximate size and then click on the width of the rectangle to enter the exact size. At the bottom of the page, in the new dimensions section, enter the desired size, which is 0.1 here. We do the same for the thickness. If the drawn rectangle is moved after entering the dimensions, select a tool that looks like a mouse display from the toolbar and place the rectangle in the coordinate center. From the edit base extrusion window, consider the length of the workpiece as 2 meters and click on OK. Our model is now created. In the module section, select the property option and enter the edit material window and specify its properties. In the mechanical section, select elasticity, then elastic. We import Young's module equal to 210 GP. We also enter Poisson's ratio equal to 0.28. Then we click on OK. Next, we create a section that is solid and homogeneous. Then click on continue and then OK. In the following, we'll assign a section. Then, because the color of the workpiece changed to green, it means that the material properties have been applied correctly to the workpiece. Change the module to assembly. Select the independent option and finally click on OK. You can see the coordinate axis. Next, we enter the submodule and create a static general. Click on continue. In the Edit Step tab, set the step time period to 1, then change the initial and maximum incrementation size to 0.1. Finally, we'll have 10 increments to solve. Here, change the module to Load. Click on the second icon on the left side of the toolbar. In the Create Boundary Condition window, select the initial option from the step section. Next, we select both sides of the piece fork and confirm it by the Done option at the bottom of the page. For the loading section, click on the Create Load icon and select Step 1 from the Step section. And in the Types for select the Step section, select Pressure. Next, select the desired surface. In the Pop-up tab, click on FX. Then create expression field and enter the expression 70 times sine pi z. Click on OK. Next, in Edit Load tab, choose analytical field in distribution section and enter 1 in magnitude. As you can see at the beginning of the work, which is between 0 and pi, the load is applied downward. Then, when it crosses from pi and moves towards 3 pi divided by 2, we have the maximum load upward, and then its value decreases again and becomes 0. Now we select Mesh Module. Click on the first icon on the left toolbar. In Global Seats tab, consider approximate global size equal to 0.02. C3D8R elements are used in the created mesh. In the following, change the module to Job. Click on Job Manager and create job with the name of analytical field. Please note to run the samples faster, we can change the number of CPU in the parallelization section. We repeat the same steps for the second model using subroutine Dload. Change the module to Load and consider the distribution as user-defined. Our model is ready to run the Dload subroutine. Now let's write the code. Here you can see the Dload subroutine parameters. F as amount of load, K step as step number, KINC as increment number, NOEL as element number, NPT as integration point number. To avoid repeating the word chords, encoding chords 1, chords 2, chords 3 are defined in the user parameters section as X, Y, and Z respectively. In the following, we have defined the number pi up to 6 decimal places. Q is also the parameter for load. In the next part, we call the number of elements, the number of integration points, and the amount of load to give us these three parameters before applying the subroutine. We could remove this part as it's not necessary for our code. The only reason we did it is to record the values in the log file to check if we have any error. Eventually, we entered the loading itself, which is Q times sine pi z. The value of Q is already defined as 70, and Z is our variable which changes for each element and point of integration. As we explained, Z variable represents our Z direction. The point to note is that the loading that applies to the surface here first applies to the integration point. Then the Abaqus software automatically converts them from integration to nodal force. Next, again, we record the value of Z, which changes at any integral point, as well as F, which is a function of Z. Again, it's not necessary, but it's good to record the data in a log file. Now we create the second job. In the general tab, load the subroutine file as we did it in previous tutorials. Until the file is run, let's look at a good example that is done using subroutine Dload. Here you can see the UIC60 rail model that these two rails are connected using thermite welding. In the image on the left, you can see the UIC60 profile with all its dimension written in millimeters. And the picture on the right, you can see the spring and damper, which is used instead of the ballast and the traverse as they are substructure under the rail. Here you can see the dimensions of the thermite well, or in fact the dimensions of the load, which is inserted in a rectangular dimension of 20 by 15 millimeters. This loading is defined in the Dload subroutine. The loading starts from the point indicated in the image, passes through the thermite well, and exits at the end. One of the advantages of subroutine is that we don't need to model the three-dimensional model of the wheel, which saves us time while giving us acceptable results, as the loading done here is equivalent to the wheel pressure. Here you can see the thermite welding model and two rails with thermite welding. Also, the considered properties and the welding properties of thermite respectively. In interaction, we have created springs and dampers. Next, the defined loading, which is deload, and finally, you can see the model with mesh. If you're interested, you could download the files from the link on top as well as in the description. Now we're back to the models to look at the results. The deformation you see here is 1,000 times the scale to see the deformation clearly. To eliminate the element lines, go in the common plot options, select the free edges option to see the model better. Here it shows the solution is done in 10 increments. Now we go to the subroutine section and compare the results. The left part is done using analytical field, and the right part is done using subroutine Dload. Now we create a path from the toolbar. Then we create XY data from the path. The shape of the graph is sinusoidal, as at first it began extremely low, then rose, then fell, and then rose again. Do the same for the model on the right side. As you can see, the diagrams of the two models are quite similar. I didn't do this part with much of details, but if you are interested, please visit our website linked on top for more details. Before finishing this video, I'd like to show you the recorded data such as the element number, the integration point number, and the load that applied before subrouting. These are recorded in a log file. As it is shown here, we have number of elements, the integration point, and the load before applying on part. To make it clear, we move to subrouting. As you can see, the output is because of this command line. To check it, we choose this line to calculate the output by a calculator. We have the location here, and by multiplying to pi and getting sine, then multiplying to 70 will have the exact number as it is written here. The log file has other purposes as we'll explain in the video linked on top and the description. I hope you enjoyed this video, and until the next one, bye!
This video was made by Salman Hosseini. To find his contact information and his updated resume, please visit our website, hyperlyceum.com. Salman is an expert in Abaqus, 3Matics, Mimix, SolidWorks, CATIA, and a few other engineering software. To plan online sessions and discuss industrial and academic projects, please use the provided email under Salman's contacts. The cost of the projects vary depending on the complexity of the work and can be discussed in advance. We look forward to working with you.